So I'm Andy. You know how to spell it. And I'm one of the two Aquarius overlords.
And I'm Alan. And I also am an Aquarius overlord for the co-owners of Aquarius Records.
But don't put co-owner under mine. Put overlord. I was listening to some radio show, and they were talking about how there was no good new music, and they were referencing lots of random sort of MTV things, and it seems so obvious that these were just people who didn't either know where to look or weren't willing to put in the effort. And I think art and music, good art, good music, has always required that the listener or the viewer or the person appreciating it does some of the work themselves.
I think it's kind of a strange thing that metal has such a strange image of being childish and kind of stupid. It's kind of ironic that it's the 21st and late 20th century equivalent of classical music. I mean, you're talking about contemporary people composing what generally would be considered operas with the latest musical instruments available.
It's part of this larger extended network that we're a part of. And to me, that's one of the most satisfying things about doing this stuff is just making connections with other people and being involved with the really active, progressive, interesting community of labels and musicians and artists.
Hydrohead has become a label that champions creative music for the sake of making creative music, not for the sake of selling records.
They were supporting the avenues for independent music to happen, and they saw in especially heavy aggressive music something perhaps more unique happening in their area. You know, they saw intelligent artsy kids making heavy music.
Majors, Vacation Vinyl, Vacation. It's definitely an extension of Hydrohead Records because this idea, you know, came from the music business and what Hydrohead's involved with. And Hydrohead having the means and the connections within the industry to say, yeah, this is where it's going. Vinyl's what we're about. Vinyl's what we want to support. And lucking out enough to find a good spot to do it and to drag me over here to run it.
My name's Aaron Turner, and I'm a participant in Hydrohead Records and Isis, and I'm a founder of both as well. But I look at both of them as being very cooperative entities, and I certainly don't take sole credit for either. To me, doing the label just was born out of a desire to participate on a greater level in this scene, this network that had really inspired me. I feel like labels like Neurot and Hydrohead and the other ones mentioned really do have a following of dedicated listeners, people who are like, well, I'm gonna pick this up because I trust this label to deliver not necessarily a specific sound, but a level of quality that I find interesting.
Every single band on Hydrohead sounds different for the most part. I don't think they ever released the same thing twice. But I've always felt like every band that I've been told or know that's on Hydrohead, it doesn't take that much of a leap of logic to feel like there's a reason for why they're on the label. It's like, oh yeah, I mean, it's Oxbow, it's Hydrohead, you know? It's Pelican, it's Caven, it's Hydrohead material.
Thank you.
that was one of my original ideals, was just to create sleeves that were visually strong on their own, but also were complementary of the music that they were representing.
At least with Aaron, it's born of just being, having sort of a vision. You know, I think that's where, for him at least, and for most people I know, it was what your album looks like is as important as what it sounds like. Those Old Man Gloom records look so amazing. Those are some of the best designed records ever, and it's not just because there's monkeys on them. They really look amazing, and I can't actually envision them looking any other way. And I think that's what a designer or a band or a label is always shooting for.
I mean, as an artist, working with like Hydrahead is like a perfect situation to be able to, because they work with artists that they respect enough to let them do their thing. They've got their series of live records, and the live five is them playing Oceanic all the way through. So they wanted to do, for the vinyl version, a limited release that comes with a special limited edition silkscreen cover. So Aaron asked me to do a cover of that. It's almost like kind of coming full circle back to like when I was listening to Oceanic and didn't know them and working on my own work, and now I get to do a cover for a release of Oceanic Live.
Yeah, there's so many crossovers, definitely, with musicians and with artists. If I'm working on a poster design, trying to come up with ideas, I'll put the band on and just listen to it and kind of doodle. I do a lot of writing beforehand, just kind of brainstorming, like word association, so whatever pops into my head. You know, so sometimes it's a feeling I'm trying to match, like the vibe of the music, or sometimes I'll take part of a song lyric.
I think it's important to do a cover that shows that the cover artist really respects the music. I think that comes across if you treat it in a certain way. And then for the person that purchases it, I'd like them to be able to sort of really look into it and have fun looking at it.
The last few things I've done for us have been photo-based. I wanted to do some drawing this time around, and hopefully the other guys will like it. We'll see what happens.
When I think of Aaron, I don't think of like this really business-savvy guy. I think of a really great artist and a really great musician, and you know, he does this label, and he has Mark, who was a friend of his, and Mark is a great businessman, and he's really great at that. You know, he's really great at dealing with bands, and he's, you know, on top of getting things put out, and they were friends, and Mark has this strength and Aaron has this strength, and together they can really get things done.
I was thinking independently of taking on a partner, someone that could really help me shoulder some of the responsibilities and sort of take the label up to the next level, basically out of my bedroom and into the room next to it.
This is the guy who runs our label.
Honestly, my nuts hurt.
You slapped me
in
the
middle.
That's who runs our label.
I just thought, well, let's give it a shot and see what happens. I guess it was sort of like entering the next phase when it became more serious.
Have you seen this?
What am I?
Oh, are you gonna take for a walk?
Yeah, you wanna go for a walk?
Yeah, let's go for a walk.
You know, not necessarily everybody loves all of the music that we put out, but they like the vibe and like what we're about, you know? So, yeah, it's a good posse, I'm psyched on it. Sometimes I wonder if like we're actually getting enough, as much done as we should be, based on how many fucking people are there. But I have no point of reference, so I think that we kind of kill it. I think so.
Yeah.
Besides, I like the environment. I love how all the bands come to town and they just, it's like, it's cool.
Hey.
Hello there.
How you doing?
I'm pretty good.
Hey, Kenneth. How are you going, man?
How are you?
Not bad. Yeah.
What's this? What's that?
Yeah. Promo mailers.
Oh, yeah.
Shit. For this guy's album.
Which guy is this?
This guy.
What's the name? Oh, Godflesh. That's all I'm known as, really. Yeah. You know what I mean? I'll never shake it off, so.
would be an understatement to say that he's been influential in the realm of underground metal as well as mainstream stuff. I mean, I don't think, for better or for worse, I don't think bands like Korn and Fear Factory and shit like that would have happened or happened the way they did without Justin and Godflesh.
I heard you're in
some
Jesus band.
Yeah. Sort of like a Christian thing, you know, like highly influenced by Stryper and you know, the good stuff from the '80s, Joe, man.
I love Yezu. I love Yezu more than I love Godflesh. I'm sorry, Justin. Maybe actually he likes that. What I like to say is like doom gaze, this marriage of shoegaze and doom out of the ashes of Godflesh, and then making these textures and these landscapes, this oral, like, just beauty that comes from the harmony of the fuzz of the guitar and his vocals.
But also someone who's been through so many different label experiences, from tiny little, you know, indies to huge majors. You know, it felt good to have someone who lived through all that come to us and feel good being there.
Get me away from the camera and closer to the sandwich. Yeah.
Just like
friend. Yeah, she'll eat that right out of there.
Yeah, without a doubt. I mean, I can hear a lot of Justin's past in general coming through in Yezu. And I think he's one of those people who, whether he accepts it or not, which I think he does, he has a sound that is very much identifiable. Never been a label that tries to bind artists to us. We rarely sign contracts, which is not necessarily the best business practice, but in the few instances that we have, we've never made agreements with bands where they owe us, you know, like 4 LPs once they sign a contract. We want bands to be excited to work with us, and we feel like if we're doing a good job, they'll want to stay with us.
Please kill me. Kill me.
There is no way that I would think that it would be anywhere in anyone's interest in terms of our band to sign to a major label. I think that major labels exist. They don't have an interest in anyone's music. They view your music as a product.
I don't think any of us ever wanted to be caught up in any industry bullshit or all the crap that comes along with being in a band. I don't think any of us are really interested in. I think we all just want to make music with our friends.
Caven, another Boston band, interesting. I think kind of like the first success that Hydrahead saw with a band on their roster. A band that has continually evolved to them getting signed to RCA.
Caven can do anything they want. They can do Until Your Heart Stops Metal, they can do proggy, spacey, Jupiter stuff, and they can do Antenna, which were fucking awesome pop songs, pop fucking radio songs. Yeah, that's what they were, but they were great.
And to know the guys in that band is to know that they love, you know, their prog rock as much as they love their death metal. And I think they've always found a marriage of those sounds.
There's absolutely no reason why Caven should not be huge right now. Absolutely none.
name's Adam McGrath. I play guitar in Cavin.
My name is Steven Brodsky, and I play guitar and sing in Cavin. Can we not be dropping Zippos during my my speech?
They were pretty early on. I think their first 7-inch was Hydrahead 19.
We did the first Crossbarrow record with Aaron, then we did Beyond Hyperthermia, which is a collection of all our, like, 7-inches that all a bunch of random hardcore kids put out. And then we did Until Your Heart Stops, which was right at the time when we became a 4-piece. Then we did Jupiter. We did the Jupiter tour, and that's when the kind of major label factor came in. You know, we had a publicist for Jupiter at the time, and she was kind of instrumental in bringing a lot of people into the picture. And then, you know, just people just come to these shows, but we certainly weren't looking for it.
We had never even, you know, played with the idea of, you know, ever leaving Hydrahead to pursue any other label, let alone a major label.
We started off wanting to be like our friends and like our idols.
Like Converge,
you know, they were from our area. Like, you know, we want to play a show with Converge, and those were our initial goals, you know?
Whatever makes you tired, the resting always fails. 'Cause anywhere you lay yourself's about a nail.
We were happy for them. We wanted them. I mean, if they could have become like the next fucking Radiohead, nothing would have pleased us more, you know? We were psyched for them to have this opportunity to, you know, really have a go at it and do music full time.
It's really cool that they're on MTV and that you're hearing them coming out of people's cars driving around, you know, town and so forth. It wasn't so much like I've never heard anything like that before.
Yeah, but you felt, you know, the same way when
Nevermind came out. I was like, oh.
The Melvins got signed to Atlantic. You were like, what the fuck? And then, like, Butthole Surfers. You're like, who ever thought that Butthole Surfers would, A, get popular, but B, then start sounding like Beck.
Yeah, so.
If you paid attention to the radio when those songs were on, which, by the way, is probably one of the only times in the last fucking 10 years that either one of us has paid attention to the fucking radio.
It's true.
They fucking smoked everything that else was on the radio. So really, what we're talking about is a label that didn't promote something properly.
We were up without an A&R person for pretty much the most important periods of the time that the label was supposed to be working to promote Antenna. I guess that's pretty much what put the record, quote-unquote, dead in the water.
Dead in the water.
Learned that from the industry.
Yeah, they have all these slang words that we stole.
Lowballing.
Lowballing, pulling the trigger.
Yeah.
Ready to go over the cliff together, which we stole for lyrics.
We're going over the cliff together!
Okay. We saw this band, they sold X amount of records on an indie label with almost no real financial backing. Why don't we take what they do, make it a little more palatable, and put all this money into it? It's a guaranteed sale. I mean, that's the logic, but it almost never works. Almost never. Nine times out of 10. Because the people who are trying to sell these bands don't get them. We said this from the beginning. Anytime you guys want to come back, we're here for you. We don't harbor any ill feelings. We love what you do. We love you as people. We want to continue working with you.
Really, when you have your heart invested into doing any sort of art, you know, you got to accept a death of certain kind of those things, so that you can, you know, begin new lives with the same art and advance yourself, you know, and like, you know, I guess Corporate Cavin is dead, and we're okay with it, you know. Perfect Pitch Black is the grave marker, and so it's all sort of new pavement.
We were still together, you know, we're still putting our lives into it.
Let's turn, oh Lord, my friend.
in 10 years, I hope people say that Hydrohead put out great records by Caven and Botch and Daughters, and not say that it was run by the guy from ISIS.
The label came before any serious musical projects. I mean, I had always wanted to be in a band from the time I started playing guitar, but it wasn't until after I had already started Hydrohead that I really started getting involved with bands that were doing anything beyond practicing a few times a month or a year or whatever.
I mean, I've been in bands for almost my whole life, and we would always be like, hey, are you home? Hey, do you want to meet late? You know, and Aaron, every time I talk to Aaron, he's like, I have band practice Monday through Thursday from 11 to 2 p.m. Like, it's totally just a part of his, you know, daily schedule.
In a lot of ways, I think ISIS has helped Hydrohead become more known to a certain extent. I mean, people have discovered Hydrohead through discovering ISIS and vice versa.
What struck me about ISIS first time I heard them was the ferocity that they were bringing to a metal sound that I hadn't heard before. A roller coaster of kind of up and down between the heavy, the kind of you roll with as it gets crunchy, as it gets quiet, as it starts soaring.
ISIS were folks that we had met on the road, you know, and they were young, and, you know, now I think they'd probably be considered a veteran band by this point.
These weren't guys that were muscle-bound, you know, spiked, you know, metalheads. These were guys that were making this kind of different, heavy music.
ISIS is very much a collective, and everything that each of us have experienced as individuals has, in one way or another, affected the output of ISIS.
I'm Aaron Harris. I play drums in ISIS.
I'm Mike Gallagher, and I play guitar.
I'm Clifford, and I play guitar and keyboards and whatever else in ISIS.
My name is Jeff Kashid. I'm the bass player for ISIS.
September, it'll be 9 years, and Aaron, and myself are the three original members.
So I had known Mike from working with him quite a while. Also Jeff and Cliff. So the four of us minus Aaron Turner all worked in the same music warehouse called Newbury Comics. Yeah, because Cliff was in the Gersh, so that, and I was in Logan, Mike was in Cast Iron Hike. We were all kind of doing bands at the time, so it wasn't really, never really thought of playing with those guys until it just kind of worked out that way.
It's one of the greatest inspirations to me are the other people that I play with. You know, they have a very different perspective on the way, you know, they create music and the things that inspire them. And, you know, I totally feed off of that. And that's the reason, you know, that I play with these people. I mean, we wouldn't have lasted nearly as long as we have if we didn't appreciate each other as people and also as musicians.
We don't have a manager, we do this all ourselves, so there's a lot of stuff to be done. It's our full-time jobs right now, and you know, I think we all look at it that way. A lot of people have always, over the years, told us that our live show was a lot more intense in ways than our records. And just thinking of ways to try to capture that live vibe, I think, you know, we decided that we'd all try to play together so that You could hear what everybody was doing and get a little more into the mood of the song.
Ourselves when it comes to songwriting, and there's a lot going on. There's a lot of different styles, so it's hard for me anyway to commit to saying it's this record, it's that record, as you want me to do, and I'm probably not going to, so sorry.
It's mostly instrumental, metal-influenced prog rock.
I mean, what makes something proggy? You know, Pink Floyd is as simple as it comes, but that was definitely progressive rock. But it sounds absolutely nothing like Yes, who is also a progressive rock band. So, like I say, it's really hard to say. I just like to say, you know, we're a rock band, and we play, you know, rock music.
Yeah, we're pretty anti-genre as far as that fucking shit goes. I don't know. Whatever. If you dig it, then that's fucking awesome. Thanks.
Labels that are defined by the people that run them, and they are an extension of their personalities in that regard. Mm-hmm. And I think that's why labels like Neura and Constellation and Hydrahead and Ipecac and whatever else have more of an audience than, you know, some of these more like faceless entities that don't have any real driving force behind them.
It's not just a business we started, it reflects on our entire adult life. It reflects on everything we've done since '85. the band doesn't belong to any one of us. The label doesn't belong to any one of us. It is our community and our brotherhood and our dedication to each other and our dedication to the spirit that drives us is what makes any of it possible. And we were a band before we ever had a label, which is probably the difference.
For us, it just became a matter of like doing something that was significant to us. We were in a warehouse. There was a bunch of other bands in there. We did gigs out of the warehouse. There were times when we wouldn't leave the warehouse except to go across the street to the liquor store for 6, 7, 9 months, whatever. Everything we needed was there. Our whole everything. Me and Dave and Jason, we were doing another band before. We connected so strongly together that we decided to do something else. We basically looked at examples of a few different bands in history and just said, these bands set themselves apart. Amoebics and Celtic Frost, Voivod, you know, Black Flag was just starting to enter the end of their run, but you know, all those bands were really, really big at our warehouse. The Swans, all that stuff was there. We really are a product of that environment.
We just wanted to try to embody the spirit of all that we had heard without sounding like any of it.
That was in winter of 1985. 89, Steve joined. We needed to have a family. We needed to form a family and commit to each other. And so that's what we did. And that's what took us through everything that we've been through in 21 years now.
In order for us to deliver what we feel is an appropriate display of the music is to completely surrender ourselves to it and let it flow through our bodies as if our bodies are the conduit of it right out of the earth out through the speaker.
You can sense what came before, but that, I mean, there's nothing wrong with that at all. The idea is to give it, to twist it and turn it into a thing that's totally, totally your own.
Neurosis's sound, I call it heavy, I call it doomy, I call it dark, at times folk.
What are they classified as? I don't know, it's really hard to pinpoint.
It's a lot easier for me to describe other people's music in relation to Neurosis than it is for me to just describe Neurosis.
I don't know what it is, man. It's metal, it's... I don't know, it's Neurosis. That's, I mean, I think anyone you ask is gonna say that, you know.
They sort of took something that was only really going on in the kind of stoner doom thing. Like you were hearing these bands like Cathedral that are playing doom metal and it's like so slow and all this stuff. And they took it and they said, no, you know, we're not gonna do this for the sort of pure spectacle value of it. We're gonna try and use this heavy, sludgy instrumentation. Yeah, shut up, dude. And we're gonna try and make it into something that is like narrative, that is like actually about trying to make something beautiful.
It's a machine, you know?
Yeah.
I like machine-like music, definitely.
Whenever they say, you know, what would you classify Neurosis as, you know? I don't know. You know? I'm in the middle of it, I have no idea.
And this is without, you know, coming into play of their artwork, their visual performances that go behind their live shows.
Pictures, the sounds, the volume, the intensity to either extreme has to do with creating a mood that not only that doesn't dictate an experience to someone. The mood creates an atmosphere that demands that people, if they're going to enjoy it at all, they have to open themselves up to it and invest themselves into it.
Me, for a living, like, I'm always working in film and we're compositing photoreal people into backgrounds that we make in 3D or assemble out of photography. My first sort of experimentation with that was the Given of the Rising artwork, and it spawned an entire new outlook for me as for what I do in art and photography. That, for me, is to create an entire experience or a new environment and world for all these releases.
Heavy metal and or darker music in general has always kind of had more of a connection to, like, visual art. Being a visually oriented kid, I was always attracted to things like Pink Floyd with their, like, you know, strong aesthetic, or Iron Maiden, or Megadeth, or, you know, anybody that had, like, a strong visual element that brought you in.
I get a lot of stoned guys coming up to me at shows going, "Yo, man, we looked at that Neurosis album cover on acid for like a day." It's true.
The things that people call scenes come and go and they pass, and really we were always just kind of left as the black sheep. And so we thought it would be best and most pure, since we basically give our sweat, blood, and our spirit and our soul into everything we do, it'd be best if it all came from us.
Again, it comes back to the control thing. Eye of Every Storm was the first record that we ever put out that we wrote, recorded, did the artwork for, and put out by ourselves. So it's all us, you know? So if there's something wrong with it, if there's somebody to talk to, it keeps it simple.
They weren't really concerned about staying within the strict confines of what being a band meant. You know, they extended that to, you know, into the idea of running a label that's sort of curated by a band in a way.
Neurot has done that more than anyone else, branching out within the same circle and the same family to collaborate with people that they've released records from.
We appreciate the incestuous nature of a lot of what we're working with, you know, in that the friendship and the family and the interconnection has a lot to do with how bands like us were ever able to exist in the first place.
This Storm of Light project, I think also his evolution coming from the visuals of Neurosis, his stint in Red Sparrows, and what he's doing now really carries on what Neurosis started.
but on his own side, his own, like, his own outlook of the music and what he's creating.
I don't know, being in Red Sparrows and playing instrumental music, it was fun for the most part, kind of starting in Storm of Light. It was initially sort of more of a kind of cathartic release, wanted to play heavier music, branch out and be able to expand, like, my musical base, not really be so trapped or confined into, like, the post-rock element. The Storm of Light is kind of moving out of that genre of music and experimenting with some, you know, shorter and heavier stuff. The name Storm of Light, we really liked it because it can kind of be anything. It can be the light at the end of the tunnel or the light at the beginning of the tunnel. It can be birth or death, sort of embodies what lyrically we talk about and art concepts and the visuals, as well as sort of the more environmental beliefs that the band follows or discusses.
Neurosis, you know, we give all these bands that we're putting out, it's Neurosis's money. You know, it's we sold our records, we don't take any profits home, we reinvest it to be able to put out other people's music. So we've sacrificed, you know, we've sacrificed our own resources to be able to put out something that we like and something we want to get behind and support it.
Oxbow, for instance, which is like probably my favorite thing that we've put out for some unknown reason. I can't really put it in, give you a reason why, other than I, on an intuitive level, totally understand what they're doing and believe that it, like, has to be done.
You can go to Relapse Records, and you can go to their website and their forum and type in Oxbow, and you'll get pages and pages of people talking about how much they like Oxbow. You've got guys from Relapse writing us, but at one point I approached them about putting out an Oxbow record. They're like, no, we can't, no. No. So, you know, it's a band that everybody wants to like, but at the same time, you know, liking it and, you know, willing to pay for it because you like it are two different things.
Oxbow's always been the oddball. You know, they've been around a long time, and they've been putting out great CDs, and they're always under the radar. So if they have a chance to, you know, maybe get the word out in more places, then I think more power to it, because people need to experience that.
With certain labels, they feel like they're more in competition with each other, and others feel like they can work together.
And Mark and Aaron talked to Steve and said, we'd like to do something with Oxbow, do you mind? And he said, let me talk to Oxbow. And so Steve called me and said, Hydrahead wants to do a record with you guys.
One, we don't sign bands to contracts. You know, it's like, we know how that felt for us to be in a situation.
Guys, and I was like, well, fuck it. He goes, let me explain it to you in a language you'll understand. Hydrahead will give you money to do a record. And we said, oh.
I don't think people need to be so exclusive. You know, I don't see why it's a bad idea for bands to release stuff on several cool labels.
Oh, you guys took a chance on us, you did it, we'll stick with you. And he goes, what I'm saying now to you is that we're willing to have you do this. I think it would be good for you guys.
Yeah.
You know, there's no reason why people on the same side need to be getting involved in that kind of overdramatic bullshit. We'll be right back.
way that you get people to like you is to do what you think they would like often. And that hasn't been the case with us. But it works out really well as far as being happy.
There's an expectation if you make music, and we understand that music is a business, but there's an expectation that you would be in business to be successful in business. I think where you have divergent roads and where you find that people, what their ideas of business are, you know. Our idea of business may not necessarily mean that we make $1 million and have fur coats and Rolls Royces, you know.
Like I do.
Made Out of Babies was awesome because it was a demo, you know, that came in the mail. And, you know, they came out of it with just these original riffs, this great, powerful sound, tight rhythm section, and an original voice, you know, one that you don't hear in heavy rock a lot.
Someone from Capitol Records called and was, you know, that's kind of a thrill because, you know, you're going to make money, but it seems more fulfilling in the long run to have someone say, you know, someone that you respect.
And they also,
musically.
Yeah, exactly. I've been a fan of Neurosis since my teens, been seeing them play, et cetera, and it's pretty amazing.
There's a watered-down version of Isis and a watered-down Neurosis and a, you know, I think, like, that's probably who they get the bulk of their, you know, demos from. But we sound completely different from most of the stuff on their label, and I think that that appealed to them in some way, you know, for them to take a chance on us, and they did. I can feel your insights.
Bands like the Grails, you know, it's like, you know, I've played them for people before who go, wow, you know, you guys put this out. And it's like, yeah, it's the same. To me, the way we see things, it's the same thing. It's the same thought, you know. It's a different interpretation of the same energy.
And I read something once about a Grails record where someone up in Portland first heard them and thought it was so fucking brilliant that they just had to smash their TV. That they didn't want to watch anything anymore because of how moved they were from Grail's sound, which also has a lot of instrumentation to it and can be dark, but also very psychedelic.
You can tell they really gel together, that they are revolving around these forms of music which reference something both new and refreshing and exciting, but also something ancient and archaic. You know, there's a familiarity there, but you haven't heard that music before. But it feels right, like you have.
That kind of music is a very much more introspective or artistic form of expression. It's not just like pop music where they're trying to like create a perfect pop song. They're trying to create personal, some kind of music that's a personal expression of whoever's writing it.
Well, here's people who have been instrumental in terms of, you know, laying out a path that we've ended up, you know, sort of following to a certain degree.
We all have our favorite songs that we play. We all have our favorite bands that we've put out, you know. But we all agree that it's all worth doing.
again, we've just been through a lot of life together. We've been together our entire adult lives.
It just feels to me like their music has evolved, and like, and they've gotten older. They all have families. They've all got, you know, they're not like, everybody's gotten older, and like, aging does something to you. It changes you, for sure. You know, you're not, you can't be 23 and raging on tour forever. It reflects, you know, accumulated experience.
At a certain point in our existence, we realized that all that really mattered, aside from the fact that we remain true to ourselves and that we are doing this for our own personal and self-centered reasons while we're creating music, was that what our legacy is that we leave behind. We're the ones recording it, we're the ones doing the artwork and doing all the hard work of promoting it and everything. Then that's craftsmanship. That's true art. That's coming from a more traditional value of where our music comes from.
And that's it. I mean, we're committed. That's our commitment to each other, is that we will do this until one or all of us is gone.
Sometimes it feels like a war for your soul, that you have to do these things for your soul, and if you didn't, your soul is what would pay. And that sounds heavy for most people just into music, but for us, that's how it's been.
Heavy to me doesn't always imply metal. Heaviness to me is more about the physicality of the music rather than, you know, if it's metal or not.
I like to think that the music that's really, really amazing and emotional and personal and beautiful is the kind of music that people would make anyway. Like, and they aren't actually thinking about how it's gonna sell or, you know, like that's an afterthought, and a lot of people are annoyed by having to think about that part of it, but they're just sort of compelled to make music.
The definition of what is independent is so completely skewed. I really do feel like what Constellation is doing is the honest to God truth of what independent is.
I think that Godspeed You Black Emperor had a lot to do with this movement of bands, without a doubt. I think they proved to a lot of people that you could do it and that there was an audience for it.
And Godspeed for me sort of tapped into something that I, you know, really resonated for me.
We'll be right back.
Kostianilavsky, co-founder, Constellation Records.
Don Wilkie, Donwilkie.
Constellation didn't actually start with a band or a release or records in mind right off the top.
The groups that they are putting out, a lot of those people have been making music and doing records for the most part way before Constellation ever gets started. But that's, I think, the way a lot of labels get started, is there's all this great stuff going on, nobody's documenting it.
There was nowhere to play in Montreal at the time, and we were hoping to start a place for bands to play. And somehow through friends of friends, heard that these guys, Don and Ian, were looking to do the same thing and we should hook up with them.
And this Ephraim, who was one of the ringleaders of Godspeed You Black Emperor, and his friend John Tinhold, who at the time was doing woodworking and bookbinding and has since helped out on artwork and design for some of the early Constellation releases. They were sharing a loft space called the Hotel Tutango.
And Ian talked our ears off, and Don didn't say much at all, and so we met like that.
People that know Constellation Records now will see has evolved into a recording space that most of the Montreal bands that we work with have recorded at.
And that was around the same time that Godspeed started playing the Hotel Tutango.
At the beginning it was me, Ephraim, and Mike. So it's your typical, you know, rock band, except we were instrumental. And I guess probably sound like Pink Floyd.
And we came to the idea that on the four track, we just made four different tracks with four different sort of feedback drones, just literally holding a guitar up and recording as a drone for half an hour over and over on four tracks at four different oscillations.
Whether purposefully or not, is still informed by chamber music and by minimalism, you know, like Steve Reich or Terry Riley, like all that stuff in different forms has been happening. And it's just, you know, it just takes someone with like a deft touch who knows how to, it's just like what we were talking about before, who knows how to take those elements, maybe really disparate elements, and put them together and make them into something special that really sort of touches a nerve with people. And I think Godspeed definitely did that.
They certainly took some pre-existing ideas and molded it into something totally their own.
We kept adding people to the band. That was like the only job interview we had with people, was like finding people who didn't have, for real, didn't have relationships, didn't have jobs, didn't have like, weren't in university. It was like, fuck it, let's just tour.
Watching that band, definitely you could get an idea that you could use the word dark to describe what you were seeing there.
Yeah.
Especially at the beginning.
Yeah.
You know, like nobody would ever look at the audience, and it was all this really like beautiful films behind.
There were plenty of metalheads who got way into Godspeed because it was still this new thing, but it still had sort of an ominous vibe, and it still had a lot of the more ephemeral elements of metal, you know, like it was dark and it was epic.
And Constellation for me was the first kind of really cool label where I remember going to Aquarius looking for Godspeed You Black Emperor and getting the first release and pulling out the penny that was crushed on the train tracks behind the, you know, their studios and stuff up there. And I thought that was kind of cool, you know. I mean, that's even more like someone made this with their hands.
That's certainly something that I have been doing for the last 4 years, is making all the pennies, since the tracks are right beside us here. And it was definitely a lot easier for me to be manufacturing them than someone else. So I could like run and hide inside the space when the railroad cops were around. Any activity that's done late at night like that looks sort of suspicious, and I kind of get hassled for looking suspicious all the time anyways. So.
Thank you.
When I listen to Godspeed or when I listen to Silver Mount Zion, I really feel like so many people who call themselves musicians or call themselves bands are just getting away so easy. You know, like writing a 3-minute song that's basically two parts that repeat themselves. Or people who don't really give much thought to lyrics, you know, who just sort of like, well, that rhymes. And then you have a band who, here's a 25-minute song, there's 5 different parts, they're incredibly captivating. You know, they could have taken the easy road, like, you know, it just feels like, it's just generous. I find it's really generous.
When Godspeed was starting to get attention, we just pissed off a lot of people really early, and we pissed them off by sort of calling them on really basic stuff, like really, like, you got this fact wrong. I guess that ruffled a lot of people's feathers, and I still don't understand why, I guess. And it's sort of out of that, it created these memes about Constellation bands in general, that we were somehow these crotchety, preachy, like anarchist, you know.
And the day is gonna come soon where the line between resistance and complicity is gonna become really clear. So we'd like to dedicate this song to the hope and the belief that more of us will choose resistance than complicity.
The backlash against Constellation, they think our politics can be reduced to something like a bunch of barefoot hippies.
There's definitely a hippie element.
Living in some idealized anarchist community.
I probably get just chewed out for saying it, but I feel like there's like an element of hippiness.
For all of that, you know, everyone on those fucking shows, there would be someone in the band standing outside the fucking bar or club or whatever fucking venue after the show, open to talking about whatever, like, you know, and consciously. Speaking for myself, it was like, that was exactly the point that I started to get personally just kind of not less interested in doing purely instrumental stuff.
Zion was 3 members of Godspeed initially. Ephraim, who I think for the first time had just been sitting down at a piano and sketching out some really simple themes.
If Ephraim's gonna come up with another band, that's, you know, it's not gonna all of a sudden be completely, totally different. It's like his style of music or his style of playing music.
The first couple Silver Mountain Zion records, I think, are just go hand in hand with the Godspeed catalog, kind of bringing a little bit more light to the sound, making it a little bit more vibrant than the dark side of Godspeed.
It was absolutely an effort to make something, I think, much less overtly epic than Godspeed was about.
When it first started, it was just because my dog was dying. That was the only reason, was my dog was dying and I wanted to make a piece of music about that. And it made sense to do that with a smaller group of people.
More and more, the idea of group singing and of really getting behind some lyrics became like a crucial part of the dynamic, and I think has really interpersonally has made the band gel as well. We're chatty little bumpkins these days in Mount Zion. We tend to like pride ourselves on at least having read the fucking local paper the day of the show that we're playing, so we can talk about like local political figures or just see what, just to make it something broader than, you know, you're here to see our band, you know.
I beg of you,
Who has something to say that's, and I'm not putting anyone down. Who's got something to say that's not a question, that's not a compliment, and that's not a thank you? Slogan. Ironic. Question. What's that? Sorry, hang on, everyone, shut up. Someone's got her hand up. Bonus points.
For people who don't know, they're sort of like, yeah. We're just hosers, you know? Like, we're like totally chatty, like smart ass, like, yeah. Like hosers. So like, how y'all doing? Like,
I think it's been pretty special for all of us, and particularly for the Godspeed members, I think a real contrast to the, you know, heads down, lost in noise, never engaged with the audience. Everything about Mount Zion has been about, you know, trying to create an intimate environment in a venue, you know, where we stand in a circle and we really sing at each other, and we're trying to invite people to like be sympathetic to that.
Carla Bozulich is you know, prolific musician. She's collaborated with so many people.
I toured with Geraldine Fibbers for a while. Had kept a relationship with her, just thinking she's such a fabulous lady, like in so many ways.
Yeah, well, Jessica is like just a huge supporter of mine and a great friend, and she just, she's always trying to, you know, make things for everybody. It's kind of her nature. She just tries to make things rock for everybody.
I guess she came to Montreal to play a show, and I just honestly looked at her and looked at Ephraim and thought, fucking right.
I was really really, really lucky when Constellation was interested, and I was really grateful. I mean, that sounds corny, but I was really thrilled. I tried to get a lot of really cool labels interested in what I was doing for years, actually, and I just couldn't get anybody to swing to me with your high shadow.
There are a lot of people who I love who like can't stand what she does, so it's like she's just like that.
So if it's not your cup of tea or whatever people say, then it's like really not.
Yeah.
And then if it is, it really is. Like people love it or they really don't like it, which is pretty impressive.
People who don't like it are like, why are you yelling at me? Stop yelling at me.
You're dirty too.
Which really helps, and for people
thrown in the key of
just kind of feeling it.
It's not super technical music. That's not where the challenge is.
It's
the challenge
feel.
Is
like if you have the feel.
So if you
can,
if you can open yourself up to the feel and the emotion of what we're trying to do, then it accommodates all kinds of different styles.
Michael Tracy knows the most about that.
Yeah. About soul.
Yeah,
I know a lot about soul music. Soul.
As a matter of fact.
Can I do the little dance?
Oh, your dance?
I have a lot of dances.
But
it's a little condescending to call little.
The one that dances and then it ends with like...
You can't, there's no, if you'd say this, it's this type of music, it doesn't really fit because we're not really thinking about, you know, a label, like what, is this our jazz song? Is this our...
But their music's like that.
A lot of the bands on Constellation, like what's Silver Mount Zion? They're not like a... I mean, they're kind of a rock band, and we're kind of a rock band, but not really, you know. I mean, there's a lot of other things going on.
Swing to me and say one time.
Everybody. I'm looking at the set list over here, and it says that if we get an encore, we play Killed by Death, Dirty Deeds, Rain in Blood, and Ace of Spades. So I think we're at Rain in Blood.
Do Make Say Think is a band I really, really enjoy. Just unstructured, but layered and heavy as well. Heavy in the sense also that it affects you.
Just continue doing what we do. No agenda, no desire to go somewhere with it or have it be something. People start telling you, that you have a specific style and a specific agenda.
I didn't really believe post-rock too much until we did a tour down sort of the East Coast of the States. And we did a lot of shows, and every band that opened for us was kind of the same. They were an instrumental band, but then it was just like, oh, okay, this really is a scene.
Categories. I mean, you can call that vocalless metal bands or something. But there's no point of it. There's so many different bands doing different things. I think that it's sort of pointless categorizing it.
Terminology is lame. I just want to get that out there. And I feel it's completely inaccurate 90% of the time. But, you know, at some point you have to assign some sort of linguistic symbol to, you know, describe what you're talking about, and unfortunately when it comes to music, you know, you have to use those things, so.
Eventually you kind of wanted to shrug off the idea that post-rock was now what we were making, and in every review and every interview or anything, it was always Tortoise, 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 Godspeed, you know. Mm-hmm. Like, it was always that, and it was getting a bit frustrating, and I guess so much time has passed. I mean, we've been a band a decade, and it's our fifth record. They want to call it post-rock, fine.
Earlier today, my aunt was asking me, you know, how... She's like, I've been trying to describe your art to people that I know. How do you describe your art? And it, yeah, it's hard. It's hard to put a label on things.
That's a question I always dread in every interview. Uh-huh. Like, tell me about your work. Or whenever I meet somebody, my wife is always telling me, you just need to come up with some stock answer that you can just, like,
yeah,
you know, script it and be able to, like, spout it off. I'm like, I can't, because I think too much about what I do, and what I do is always changing. Like, I mean, like, sometimes I draw stuff that's more, like, cartoony, and sometimes I draw stuff that's more realistic. It's like whatever style best expresses what I want to say, so it's like, it's not really easy for me to define.
With all musical descriptors, there's a point where their limit becomes, like, pretty clear. I don't think there's, like, for me personally, I don't feel comfortable with any genre name that would fit into what I do. I mean, you could say it's noise, you could say it's ambient, you could say it's electronic music, you could say it's cathedral, goth, drone, neo, metal, you could say it's new age, and all those would work, but none of them really do as one singular name.
In the past decade, this whole, you know, indie independent thing, it just feels like it's like it's meaningless, because it's not independent, you know.
When grunge broke, everybody just went sort of bananas trying to pick up everybody they could, and the Melvins and Jesus Lizard and, you know, all these other bands got, like, scooped up, and just the guys that run these labels have been, like, you know, housing these bands for years and years and years got left in the dust.
Like, whatever you want to say about the Nirvana hangover and the co-optation of punk and truly, you know, independent rock.
It just feels like a fucking mistake to want to do that. Like, Universal, do mix for your gun, you know.
You're gonna be the next Fish.
Yeah, you're gonna be, I can just see it. You're like Grateful Dead, only hip.
Their revenue model mostly is kind of hinging on, you know, selling talent that they've developed, to use the industry locutions, to the highest bidder.
We've always said, you know, there's no way we can ever get to that level, so it doesn't matter. You know, it's like we can, you know, be as poppy as we want, we can do anything we want, because no one will ever discover Hanged Up. Like, you can get a better audience, you can get more people listening, you can get better distribution, you can get more people writing about it or what have you, but never will, you know, Top the Pops be interested.
Thank you.
no major labels have ever expressed interest in us, period.
Yeah.
I mean, even the guys at Hydro was like, come on, you know, I know you're getting emails from majors. Come on, just tell me. I'm like, no, we really honestly yeah, aren't.
Mark thought that we were, like, covering it up from him or something. Like,
there's nothing.
No, there's no interest.
Nothing. Not even, like, a fucking coffee break.
We play fucking 12-minute long instrumental songs. You're not going to fucking sell that on the radio, so they don't care.
They're not out of touch. They're just choosing not to touch that because it's pointless, because they know it's not going to sell. It's not going to keep their job.
I think that anybody who has signed us has probably, to a certain degree, not had commercialism as being their guiding ethos, you know? And I think that's probably to their credit. I mean, this stuff is art, you know? And people will listen to this well after we're dead.
They want. That's the idea. The idea is not making money. I mean, you want to stay in business, but the idea isn't to, like, make fucking millions of fucking dollars. Like, if you're playing music like that, you're not going to make millions. But that's not why they do it.
Let's face it. You're never going to find an ISIS song or a Pelican song on a 30-second commercial clip. You're just not, you know? So it's a great kind of safe place for them to be musically.
I'm not in a position that most people are when they are start bands at 20, you know, and they sort of, like, you know, go on the road for 10 years, and I'm actually, like, coming into it so late in the game, which is, you know, which is another thing about boutique labels. Like, there really are gender, age, and fashion non-specific, which is fucking awesome.
I'm always surprised that anybody wants to put records out. It costs a lot, and you usually don't get anything back from it, and, you know, your bands are grumpy and think you're holding out on them and stuff like that. But there are a lot of labels that are just interested in, like, putting out music because they love it, and I think that's pretty awesome.
I think that's what Constellation hopefully can instill in other people who want to start record labels with their bands, which is, like, a long-standing relationship that's based on respect, you know? Yeah. And so, you know, if anybody else wants to start that label, that's the most important piece of information.
We've never had a single contract. We manage ourselves well to a certain level of expectations of our own and the artist, then the number of times we're going to get burned should be small in the grand scheme of things, and so be it. That's all worth not having contracts.
Constellation is utterly worthless to anybody in the entertainment industry. I mean, we have a good faith agreement with everybody.
I think these labels were awesome because they were definitely coming from the standpoint that they wanted to put out the music that they were into. At the same time, for someone like me at the age where I was, it was turning me on to a lot of things I didn't know, and then became, like, my new favorite bands. I can't say how much that, like, spawned my love for Zenny Gaba and just wanting to get everything that Zenny Gaba put out because of that first record that Neurot put out.
And there's certain labels, SST, Discord. Not that you could predict what it was going to be, but you knew that the quality was there.
I think that was in the back of our heads. That was a label that really meant something. You would buy it if it was on SST, no matter what it was.
Neurot, Hydrohead, Constellation kind of stuff, it's not necessarily going to fall into one category. It represents, like, that sort of spectrum of stuff. Even though it's drastically different, it's kind of part of a family.
People running labels just for the love of music and going out there trying to find kindred spirits to work with, you know? We're out there grasping in a world of, in a sea of bullshit and copycats for anything of meaning or anything real. Yeah. You know, when you find it, you hold on to it, you cherish it.
You know, certain people have certain strengths, and it just, you know, they're your friends, and why not work with them, you know? It works out.
After we are dead and gone, you are gonna find that there's someone interested in what you made, because it's out there, because you put it out there as a history to document what you were about, what you were doing, whether this was a scene in a town or just your passion and what you were creating, you've left that as a legacy.
You know, just all these things are connected in one way or another, and you know, the more people you meet, the more you realize that everything really is connected, and you know, there's just all these interesting parallel organisms that are kind of floating around and occasionally colliding and combining and then splintering off and forming new things, and I don't know, it's very interesting to be a part of that.
How could we not have been talking about Old Man Gloom? I am one of the few lucky people who have seen Old Man Gloom live. It was incredible. All the members came out wearing black with just a single letter on their chest spelling gloom. Each part of this group and where they're coming from, talking of ISIS, talking of Converge, talking of Cave-In. Spacey is how I call it. It's just taking ISIS and spacing it out.
I mean, if you look at the public persona of ISIS, Cave-In, and Converge, in a lot of respects, it's very serious. There's not a lot of humor presented in the music itself. Old Man Gloom was kind of an opportunity to sort of cut loose and take things a little less seriously.
It was never meant to be a serious band. It was always just about a group of friends having fun together, just making whatever noise comes out.
That's what it is, it's our outlet to do that, and it's not a full-time band, and we sort of just come together and do it whenever we can, and so we just, you know, nothing is ever, no idea is ever too silly or shot down, you know. If anybody wants to do anything, it's like, okay, sure.
We got two songs, but they're 20 minutes each, so there's a full length right there.